My name is Ryan Anthony. I am the director of the Iowa Raptor Project with the University of Iowa. We've been around for about 35 years. It's located at McBride Nature Recreation Area, which is a park that the university owns as well. I was a biologist with Fish and Wildlife Service prior to this, which is a federal agency. I was an eagle biologist with them. So the mission of the Iowa Raptor Project is to essentially connect people to raptors and other wildlife. So education is a big part of what we do. We do education programs for children, for businesses, for families, daycare centers, senior centers, all sorts of things. We take some of our raptor ambassadors out to all these places and talk about raptors. So that's kind of the main mission that we serve here. Then also research as well. We're just starting on some of our research. We are trapping birds during migration in the fall. You know, we also provide technical expertise to some of the other people that have raptors in Iowa that are using it for education. Then we also train a lot of college students. They come and learn some specialized techniques to research and study raptors and also trap them and things like that, just field methods. So bald eagles almost also went extinct, obviously. Everybody pretty much knows that story. Now they're coming back with the vengeance, really. Some of our areas here get completely covered in bald eagles. We're right next to the water and get a ton of fish, and then bald eagles just feast on those fish. So this is our oldest bird here. She's about 35 years old, and this is a female bald eagle, and she is she's a bird old enough that she was one of the original birds that would have been listed under the Endangered Species Act. So this is our turkey vulture, Aura. This is a bird that wouldn't be here during the winter time, but literally like the first day of spring when it warms up, these birds they're here like the first day. I don't know how they know that it's gonna be warm the next day, or maybe they leave just early in the morning. But she's a pretty sweet bird. She's about 30 years old as well, and is an imprint. She's imprinted on human beings. She was actually found in the cold. She's kind of a nice bird. She might bite me a little bit, but is a nice bird in general. Very interactive. And even though, you know, these birds could be potentially looked down upon, they clean up a lot of the carcasses, you know, a lot of the deer carcasses that get left out in the wild. These guys are just eating them up. Raccoons, all the dead raccoons you see on the roads, these guys clean them up. So they might be a little smelly and a little disgusting, but they're amazing birds that have figured out a way to make their living just cleaning up carcasses. So a big service they provide, you know, preventing disease transfer from one animal to another. So this is our gyrfalcon, Zorro. Gyrfalcons are not common in Iowa, but some of them do come down during the wintertime here. These guys are northern birds, so they breed up on the Arctic. So we're actually keeping them inside with this heat wave, just because it's very hot outside for him. This is one of the birds that sometimes gets used in agricultural bird abatement. So essentially what that means is we take raptors and use them to scare off pest birds. So a bunch of blackbirds or starlings, they might go on for example, like a cherry orchard or an apple orchard and eat a bunch of fruit. Or more importantly, they'll, you know, take little bites out of some fruit and then leave it be. So they ruin a lot of the fruit, more fruit than they actually eat. We could take these birds and fly them and the birds, you know, the pest birds think they're going to get eaten. So it scares them off. And we've done that previously on cherry orchards and apple orchards in Washington State. So that's another way raptors are used in agriculture. It's a very green way of doing it as well. It doesn't kill the birds, but it protects the crop. So one of the orchards actually my wife worked at, the orchard manager said they loaded up an extra two truckloads of cherries that year because of the team of raptors that she was using at the orchards. So raptors play a huge part in our agriculture. A lot of our agricultural practices have changed a lot to, you know, essentially two main crops, corn and soybean. And corn really being kind of it's the dominant crop that the soybean essentially supports, it seems like. In those monocultures of just corn and soybeans, it's really hard for raptors to hunt. I mean, imagine 6 feet tall corn and trying to catch a mouse in there. That would be a challenge for any raptor. However, raptors can be used in agricultural practices as long as, you know, they have other places to hunt. So they may not be able to hunt inside the corn, but, you know, along the edges or along, you know, other crops that are planted potentially side by side, they could hunt and make a living. And then when the corn comes down, you know, they can kind of clean house during those times. Raptors can consume a lot of rodents, so it can really benefit agriculture. I mean, if you think about it, as a country that protects a lot of crops, you know, billions of dollars of crops are protected by just raptors. Our barn owl here, for example, she eats about 4 mice a day. So, you know, in a year, that's what, about 1,500 mice, really, a year. And now you make a pair of them, that's twice as much. So breeding pair, and then when they're raising chicks, as chicks, they eat a ton of food, you know, and they eat about 3 times as much during the day as the adults do. So you multiply that, it ends up being about a barn owl family raising about 3 chicks, which really they raise about anywhere from, you know, 3 to 7 chicks. They might consume, you know, 7,500 to, 10,000 mice in just a year. And that's just a night shift. You know, you've still got red-tailed hawks during the daytime and other raptors that might be consuming mice. So using that to our benefit is huge, you know, besides just the natural services, other services that raptors provide. This is our red-tailed hawk, you know, a very common bird in Iowa, especially during the wintertime. Tons of them migrate here, but they also, some of them stick around during the summertime as well and breed. So this would be another very important bird for Iowa agriculture. This is probably the most common bird that actually eats rodents out here. Well, a diurnal bird anyway, so a bird that hunts during the daytime. There's also other owls, so there's great horned owls and barred owls that are hunting at nighttime, but this guy's out working hard during the daytime catching mice. So this is our newest bird. This is Tiger Hawk. He's a male peregrine falcon, or more properly, in falconry, known as a tiercel. A falcon is actually a proper name for a female peregrine falcon. So this would be known as a tiercel. And this tiercel just came to us. He's about 3 months old, just over 3 months old. So he's kind of still learning his manners on the glove a little bit. But, you know, super fast bird. These guys almost went extinct in the wild, especially in Iowa. They were almost completely gone. And a bunch of release projects were conducted by falconers and by some other people. So including here as well, we released a bunch of birds out in the wild, and now they're doing fairly well in Iowa, not as well as other places, but they're not extinct in the wild anymore. And that happened because of a pesticide called DDT, which would cause their eggshells to get really thin. So when the female would sit on the eggs would just crush. So we're teaching people about essentially the hawks of the Hawkeye State. You know, that's what we're connecting people to. Our education is important to us because, you know, a lot of the landscape in Iowa has changed substantially from what it used to look like. So it's important for us to tell people about what role raptors serve in the environment and how we can restore some of the habitat and what the status of some of the species is and how we can improve that. There's no entry fee here, and we are open, you know, 365 days a year. So please come and visit whenever you'd like, and we look forward to seeing you out here.